Now, we've already seen that Plato did not think it very likely that the philosopher would become king. He said if he wanted to be practical, he may be able to institute his theory of virtue into a kingdom if the philosopher became king. But then, as we've seen, he did not think that too likely. Now let's proceed to the next part of the argument. Previously we showed Socrates' view that human society is an organism and man has parts where there should be harmony, so that if everything is in harmony, there will be justice. Now this is his case for what virtue sought for its own sake looks like. So that's now Socrates has to proceed to the other part of his case to show what justice considered as a useful good looks like, to get the other part of the argument going. And then after we see the two parts, we'll say, well, what does our reason say is the true nature of justice? We have two pictures to look at. We check our own experience. Which do we think will make us happier? And then reason makes a judgment. Our reason makes a judgment. But first we have to bring in now the other part of the argument, which would be virtue considered as a useful good. Now, to get a quick idea of what that looks like, let's go back to our four or five men. Our farmer, our herdsman, our carpenter, our shoemaker. Now, we saw that if you're going to have an organic society, they should cooperate with each other, and therefore they can specialize. So one man can grow the food, and another man can make the shoes, another man can make the furniture, and then they can trade with each other on an equal basis. No one will try to cheat. See, if you don't trust anybody, everybody has to do everything for himself. There's no specialization. One man has to grow the food, make the shoes, make the tools, raise the sheep. Each one has to do it. But if you're going to be cooperative, people can specialize, and then you have an organism. But you need to cooperate. Now, if we're going to start off with our justice is a useful good, one of those four or five, or maybe all of them, but just take one of them for the moment, he's going to think, why can't I, you know, by making agreements and all that, get them all to work for me? Why can't I enslave them if I'm smart enough? And I won't have to do anything, but someone else will farm for me, someone else will herd for me. Now, of course, they're not stupid. How can I work it to get around that? So he'll have to start out with a pleasant face of agreement, but somehow by the use of his wits, he's going to have to manipulate those other people or trick them into slavery. Now, that's the way the man thinks who has justice simply for as a useful good. He's smart. He's clever, but he's not trustworthy. And I think the best example of that type of person would be in this game of Risk. Perhaps you're all familiar with it. Five people sit down on a board, and the board represents the whole world. And everybody gets a continent with his own armies and tanks and all that. And the name of the game is, one man at the end owns the whole world. Now that's the competitive arena of a sophist. It can only be, life is an arena, competitive, there's only one winner, he's going to be the winner. That's happiness. Well, you get five people with equal arms, equal territory, how are you going to get one winner? Now, in the game, you can't just take a gun and shoot the other four. You got to do it by the game. What are the rules of the game? So what you do is you got to make treaties with people. And then you say, all right, here, let's you three make a treaty with me, and we'll attack that guy and clean him off the board. And then you got to get everybody to say, yeah, right, that's it, and they wipe him off the board. Then they're for you. And somehow you got to be smart enough to get the other two and say, hey, look, here's this guy. He's almost going to win. Wipe us off the board. Let's make a treaty. Wipe him off the board. So that, and then finally there are two of you. Well, then there's no more trickery. And then it depends if you've gotten enough territory. You win the game. That's life. Okay? That's what justice as a useful good looks like. It's useful that you make agreements. But then you manipulate and you work around and you undercut the agreement. And when you have to, you cheat or whatever, and you become a winner. That's life. So that gives you a general picture of it. Now let's see how Plato specifically describes the picture of virtue for its as a useful good. Now to understand the picture, whether when you're talking about the Greeks and you're talking about ethics or the social, you talk about the community and you talk about the individual. But you got to talk about both to get a complete picture of ethics. So what would an ideal community look like what would the ideal individual look like using our forms? Well, you'd have reason on top, spirit appetite next, pleasure appetite next. In other words, you'd have the chariot driver, reason, the one steed, spirit appetite, the other steed or horse, pleasure appetite. Then you'd have the virtues, wisdom for reason, courage for the spirit appetite, pleasure, temperance for the pleasure appetite. And then the whole combo would be a just man. So that's the... Now, in an ideal situation, that's what happens. Reason runs the appetite. And what does reason say? You got to respect the other person. You got to love virtue for its own sake. Which means sometimes you got to give your life for your friend or your neighbor. I mean, that's the picture. That's the dominant rule of reason, that life is absolutely sacred. And you have to respect it, even to give your own life. Just respect the life of another. Now, the communal picture is this. For the rulers, you have, let's say, a civilian. And a civilian has power, but the power of reason. And reason says everything should be done for the sake of the community. Then below the civilian is the military. He's the exemplification of the spirited appetite. He's the exemplification of military power, physical power, might. But he'll be subordinate to the civilian, which is interesting, isn't it? In a rational society, in an ideal setup, it isn't the gun or power or the spear or the sword that runs society. It's reason in the role of a civilian. And this is where the United States fits this classic scheme. The civilian is the commander-in-chief. He commands the army, even though the army has all the guns, all the power. The guy with the guns and the power does not run the nation. The president does, the civilian. Well, which is an exemplification of the Greek principle, reason should rule a community. Reason, therefore, should rule the way you use your military might. Secondly, besides the military class, you have the business class. Let's call them the workers, or the business class. But they look after the money and the food and the drink and all that other business. So in a properly ordered society, you have the president, the ruler, the civilian, reason over the military and over the business. Right, that's the ideal. Now, we saw that already. Now, let's go to the unideal. First step. The first step off the ideal is you move from this ideal state to a military state. That's the next step. In other words, what happens is instead of having reason over the spirited appetite and the pleasure appetite, what you have is the spirited appetite, the appetite for fighting, aggression, protection, self-defense, that takes top slot. Reason is out. The military people run things. And therefore, the civilians and the wise people are below, and so too are the businessmen and the money. They're not out for business or commerce. They're not out for truth, philosophy. They're out to win. And they're going to suppress enemies within them, and they're going to beat the enemies without them, and, you know, they'll take over the world if they can, like in the game of Risk. Now, this is the first deviation from reason, because human community is not about conquering others and suppressing the parts in itself. It's about justice, right? Well, here now we have a deviation. The military call the tune. For the individual, the spirit appetite calls the tune. And reason, you train reason here, yeah, but only in engineering or military sciences. Nothing like philosophy, nothing like poetry or any of that. Reason subjugated, money is subjugated. And there is something somewhat striking about this. They do have virtues, they have discipline, courage, give their lives. So there is something exemplary, but basically they're unreasonable. Because basically, an appetite is running the community, running the individual. And that's going to be irrational, and that's the first difficulty is going to be this. The whole community is not going to be looked after. It's simply the military looking after themselves, repressing others within it, and fighting others without it. That means there's going to be a lot of unhappy people there, who have to be suppressed by the military, or even enslaved, or who don't go along with it. So, in this competitive game, the military are winning, and they're happy, but the rest of the community isn't. And that's obvious, isn't it? I mean, you don't, it's simply the way it's going to work. You're going to have the military using force, going to dominate by force. So that's the first picture we have. And Plato calls this a timocracy. Now, in Greek, timor means honor. So a timocracy is a society based on honor, which is a society based on military power. So the first type of deflection from the ideal state is a timocracy. Now, it's pretty virtuous. It has patriotism, discipline, courage, obedience, but it's pretty warlike. So the other virtues don't get with the, and people who are not that way are simply repressed or enslaved. And then, of course, a place like this is always a danger to their neighbors. So it's made for happiness, yeah, for the winners. It's a tough world of a competitor. Winners are happy. The rest are losers. And if you're not with me, you're a loser. I mean, that's sort of the attitude. Now, and then there's a transition to the next stage. Now, the transition's interesting. He tells the story of there's his father, who's eminently philosophical, rational, and he's well off and all that. Then he has his wife and his kids. And the wife thinks the father is too much wrapped up in books, and he should be more wrapped up in social life, and take her out, because she is one of the top ladies, you know, with the top man. He's more interested in his philosophy. The servants of this guy, they say, he doesn't get all wrapped up in the court, fighting for his own property. He's interested in his philosophy, the truth. So the servants are having a talk to this young fellow and say, you need more gumption. You need more guts. Fight for your own. So now the young boy is impressed with his father, who's a wise man. So he has part of that in him. But part of this other business, he's too uninterested in the world. He's the sort maybe who'd go for the glory of the military, the vigorous, a real man. No one's going to mess with. He's going to have his rights. So that's somewhat how he explains a bit how you could have a transition from the ideal to the next. But it's not too far a fall yet. All right. We move to the next stage. In the next stage, evolves from the military, the guy may start thinking, you know, fighting wars is a tough way to make a living. Fighting wars is a tough way to get money. Fighting enemies, suppressing slaves. Why not go for the real power? Why not get money and do it by business? You don't have to fight wars. In other words, you look for peace, you do it by business. And here we have then a plutocracy or oligarchy, where the rich run things, and getting rich becomes a dominant aim. So if you look on the scheme in this, what you have is the pleasure appetite hooked up with money running things, and the rich tell the army when to fight, not the other way around. So the pleasure appetite runs the army, the spirited appetite. It also runs reason, because the only way you use reason in a oligarchy or plutocracy is you use reason to figure out how to make more money. Finances, moves, and all that business, that's the use of reason. So if you go to college and study, what do you study? Finances. What else? Military, you got to fight and die for. Philosophy, hot air, waste of time. Money. That's what makes the world go round. That's what makes the plutocracy or oligarchy go around. So now reason is down the line, and now you have the pleasure, appetite, and money sitting on top. Now, the thing is about the rich, they get powerful. You know, they get stupid, too, because they think they can make money and get richer and richer, and the rest of the poor people are going to sit around and be happy about it. They make the poor unhappy. They make for division. So you have a few of the rich very powerful, and many of the poor not powerful, not happy. So the rule of the rich, especially pride, leads to certain arrogance, stupidity, leads to revolution. They're not going to put up with it. And then, of course, the rich will have to spend their money to hire an army to put down these people, and it's going to get messier and messier. Civil war messes up things. Not good for business. You're going to have trouble. So that's the natural result of our guy cornering the money and trying to keep other people out of it. That leads to the next stage. Eventually, many times, the people win the revolution. A leader comes along, usually from the upper classes, an aristocrat, or maybe some rich guy, doesn't fit into his class, shows the poor how to fight and win, and the people win. And now we have a new power running the scheme. Yeah, the democracy, who values freedom and love, sitting on top. Reason and the old rulers down next, the military down next. Or individually put, you have the pleasure appetite, in this case, freedom. The people have freedom to do what they want. See, so they're not run by the rich. And then you have everybody subordinate to the people. Now, that's nice, everybody do what they want. Everybody's happy. You want to be saintly, go ahead, be saintly. You want to be a rogue. Do whatever you want. It's free. Democracy, right? It's a great thing, great power. The only thing is, things start falling apart. No one wants to work. No one wants to conduct business like the old skinflints of the oligarchy. You know, the old money changes. No one wants to do that. No one wants to be in the army and fight. No one wants to do anything hard. Everyone wants to do what they want to do. What happens? Country falls apart. Can't last. Has outside enemies. Then secondly, even if there are no outside enemies, they start fighting within themselves, because your freedom messes with my freedom, and you have more and more dislocation. So eventually what happens in a democracy starts falling apart. Nothing works. Nothing goes right. So you need order. And what happens then? You get a civil war about order, and then a strong man comes along and he unites the one group of people against the, maybe the rich or the other class, and he wins. And then, like our good risk player, he says to his friends, "We won. I have won this victory for you. But I have a lot of enemies because I kill a lot of people. They're out to kill me. And I'll need some protectors, like a little private army. And will you appoint this private army to me and pay for it and so on?" And a grateful citizenry will say, "Oh yes, our hero, you love us, now we love you, and we'll give you the means to protect yourself and have your own private army or bodyguard." And then the guy, when he finally sits on top, he says, "Aha, I'm the winner of the game. I'm the winner of the game of risk." Then he proceeds to do what he wants. But the people have given over the bodyguard already to him. What can they do? Now what's happening here? The winner, who's been a wolf in sheep's clothing, but finally throws off the sheep's clothing and shows himself to be a wolf, his appetites, spirited appetite and pleasure appetite, are pretty abnormal or sick. See, he's the sort of person who's engaged, who's indulged his appetites, and maybe instead of getting into maybe eating too much or too much sex, gets into kinky sex, gets into drugs, gets into addictions, becomes crazy, paranoid, sick. But the guy is smart. There's a genius. Sick as he is, he still knows how to manipulate. He still has a lot of power to manipulate. So what happens is you get a tyrant driven by sick impulses, ruling the community for sick purposes. And that's the result, final result, of pursuing justice as a useful good. A crazy tyrant who is slave to his own addictions, imposing his will on formerly freedom-loving people and making them slaves to his will. Now, this guy, of course, doesn't have too many friends. You can't trust him. And if he has a bodyguard, he has to pay them. It isn't that he trusts them, but he pays them well. And they'll be loyal to him because they know if they're not loyal to him and he finds out, he'll make them die a million deaths. He'll torture them so much they wish they were dead. I mean, he generates that type of fear. So that's the way society ends up. In the normal course, the risk player crawls over and says, "Well, I'm the winner." And, you know, you say, "Okay, so you're the winner tonight. Maybe we'll be tomorrow." But it's no blood affair, okay? This game is real. The tyrant wins, but there's blood all over the place and a great deal of fear. But he's king of the hill. So he does get to a state where he can go to bed at night and live normally. And if there's any murdering to be done, he does it. No one murders him. He murders them. So here you have the dream then of a wise guy, Thrasymachus. Smart guy, winner. Not going to be a sheep like those other Slavs. Going to be a winner, shrewd. Learn how to use justice. Here, I'll close with a last example that's just so perfect. Comes from a previous book. This is who the tyrant is. The tyrant is like a man who discovered a certain ring that made him invisible. Having discovered this ring, he went to the court where the king and the queen lived, because he was a shepherd out in the fields, and he had to give a report every year. And he reported to the king, but he had the ring. So he turned the ring, became invisible, seduced the queen. They plotted, murdered the king, and became king of the kingdom. What did he have? He had a ring that made him invisible. In other words, he could do evil and not get caught. He could do evil with impunity. And that's the great thing our expert for this life has to develop. How to use the law and not get caught. That's the art you need to be this type of a person in order to gain happiness. So that's the full picture then. We have the man, the sophist, who pursues the useful good. And we get a picture of life the way he sees it. Now we have Socrates, who says virtue should be taught for its own sake. And that's what life is all about. And so in the next tape, we will then judge which of these two views of justice is going to give us happiness. See, we got to make a judgment now. We have our notion of happiness. Which do we pick by reason? Which notion will give us happiness?